This is my 100th YouTube video, and I've learned so much about filmmaking over the past 4 years. So for this video, I thought I would share my top 10 tips, things that I wish I knew when I started. But enough talking, let's get into tip number one, decide on a vibe and stick to it. Before you start shooting, try to think about what type of video this is going to be. Is it an inspirational build video, chock full of relaxing macro shots and satisfying shop sounds? Or is it more of a high energy tutorial? Is there going to be music? Do you need to be capturing high quality sound? These things will all impact how you make the video. So it's a good idea to have at least a general sense of the vibe before you dive in and start capturing footage. And once you decide on that vibe, stick to it. Not every video you make has to have every technique that you ever learned. You only need to use what will contribute to that high level goal. It will make the video feel intentional, cohesive, and engaging. Tip number two, establishing shots. Not all videos have to be all action all the time. And in fact, most of them shouldn't be. Stories have peaks and valleys, and an important valley is letting a viewer know where you are in space. Establishing shots set up the context for a scene by showing the relationships between its important figures and objects. We all know those classic establishing shots that you see in sitcoms, where it shows the exterior of a building where the action is about to take place. But in a maker video, an establishing shot can be as simple as a wide angle shot of the workshop, showing all the tools and where you're working. Now, why is this important? Well, I think it's just human nature to want to know where we are. If your video is just macro shot after macro shot, which is something I've done in the past, it can become very disorienting and confusing for the viewer. B-roll is another great way to break up the action and really immerse the viewer. So when you're in between shots, don't be afraid to play around and capture cool, interesting stuff or an animal in your workshop. Tip number three, the 180 degree rule. This is something I wish I knew years ago, and it's a great way to really improve the watchability of your videos. And I think the best way to understand this rule is through a simple diagram. Take the subject of your shot and draw a line through it at any angle. The camera should always stay on one side of the line. Why is this? Because if the camera shoots on the other side of this line, the viewer's lefts and rights will get switched and it becomes very disorienting. Similar to tip number two, the 180 degree rule allows the viewer to orient themselves inside the scene. I definitely did not abide by this rule for a lot of my early videos, and I would frequently mix clips shot from in front of and behind my workbench. But I still shoot video in a small space, and sometimes I just really want an angle from the other side of that imaginary line. If I really want to break the 180 degree rule, I try to get an intermediate shot at an angle between the two extremes, and this seems to work pretty well. Tip number four, mix in some handheld shots. Handheld camera work adds such a dynamic human quality to videos that is impossible to get with a tripod. This can be hard if the subject of your videos is you making stuff and you're a one-person operation. But try just asking a friend or your significant other to take a few handheld shots to add to your project. Directing someone else's camera work also has the added bonus of clarifying your own vision for your video. And just because it's a handheld shot doesn't mean it has to be ultra dynamic, 300-esque style camera work that's moving all over the place. You might be surprised at the effectiveness of a mostly static handheld shot that's just slightly adjusting from time to time to keep the subject in frame. Tip number five, let the shot settle. This actually goes against some of the prevailing styles on YouTube, but if you're filming handheld or panning with a tripod, try to film a few seconds of stillness at the beginning and end of each shot. Again, this is all about giving the viewer a natural, comfortable experience. And as humans, we naturally pause our eyes at the beginning and the end of a pan. In the context of maker videos, this is probably most relevant for beauty shots. If you're filming a slow, sexy flyover of that table that you just built, try to pause for a few seconds at the beginning and the end of the shot. You'll thank yourself for it in the edit. Okay, so I realized something while I was editing this part of the video. I was looking for B-roll trying to find examples where I fully let the shot settle, and it was really hard to find examples of that, even in my more recent videos. And I think that's because this tip is more relevant for my filming than it is for the final edit.
letting the shot settle at the beginning and the end of a pan just makes it easier to stitch clips together in the edit. But I think when it comes down to it, I'm still a member of that YouTube school of filmmaking with a lot of quick cuts. When you take the time to let the shot settle, you get the added benefit of some static beauty shots, which can have a really cool effect, especially when there is a moving element to your subject. With my plywood fountain, for example, static shots of water spilling over the plywood looked super cool. And with the succulent planter, those static shots of the plants subtly waving in the wind looked really nice.
Tip number 6, zoom in. This might sound obvious, but it's something that I didn't take advantage of for many of my YouTube videos. You might only zoom in when you need to crop in a shot, but zooming can also add a really nice artistic quality to your videos. When you zoom, you're increasing the focal length of the lens, which gives you a shallower depth of field and that beautiful out-of-focus background. If you simply move the camera closer to your subject, your shot will have a wider depth of field than if you zoom in the equivalent amount. Play with your camera and try shooting a scene with a few different focal lengths to see how it looks. Tip number 7, use manual focus. You've carefully set up a shot to capture the action perfectly. You hit record, you start working, and then bam, your camera decides to focus on some random thing in the background. Don't leave it up to chance, just use manual focus mode. Don't get me wrong, autofocus is handy and it has its place. It's great when you're filming wide shots that have a lot of movement and commotion, and in shots where the subject is frequently moving towards and away from the camera. But when you're filming a mostly static subject from a tripod, in other words, the grand majority of maker videos, there's always the chance that autofocus will ruin your shot. Manual focus has the added benefit of letting you get artsy with your shots. Shooting a subject at a sharp angle with a really shallow depth of field is one of my favorite effects, especially when there's a tool moving in and out of focus. Tip number 8, lighting angles and lighting colors. Always be conscious of where your light is coming from and what color it is. For many of my videos, I made the mistake of having my two main light sources be vastly different color temperatures, and you can see these weird color casts when I use both of them at the same time. If you're getting multiple lights, make sure they're the same color temperature. If you've never used external lights, your instinct may be to put the light right behind the camera and point it directly at your subject. But this produces a very harsh effect that flattens out everything in frame and isn't the best choice for most videos. Try bringing the light to the side of the shot for a more dramatic three-dimensional look. And don't listen to the photography nerds. You don't necessarily need an expensive three-point lighting setup to have videos that look good. Work with what you have, try to stick with one color temperature, watch out for flicker, and experiment. But if you really don't have good lighting, shoot outside whenever you can. It's fun, the sawdust just blows away, and it's hard to beat natural light, as long as you keep a few things in mind. It may be counterintuitive, but overcast weather usually provides much better lighting for photography than a beautiful sunny day. The clouds diffuse the light and create a very even lighting environment that's easy to photograph, whereas direct sunlight creates very harsh shadows and areas of very bright and very dark side by side. That being said, you can't beat the beautiful warm tones that you'll get when you shoot around sunrise or sunset, otherwise known as golden hour. But this is an artistic choice, and with all artistic choices, you need to be intentional about it. Which brings me to my final tip and one of my favorites, get in late and get out early. Ever since I heard Jimmy DiResta say this, it's really stuck with me, and I think it's improved the pacing of my videos. This phrase was originally advice for screenwriters, and it means to limit a scene to what is essential to the story. When the viewer comes into a scene, the action should already be happening, and when they leave a scene, the action should still be happening. As Alfred Hitchcock said, movies are like life with the boring bits cut out. This advice isn't only for Hollywood screenwriters. It applies to maker videos as well. Don't waste time showing yourself measure and mark out every single piece of wood. Get to the action. Now, this might seem to go against my tips about establishing shots and letting the shot settle. But like every tip on this list, it's just a guideline and it's all about context. Sometimes a shot of you marking out a piece of wood is vital to the story, and it can also be very aesthetically pleasing. But an 8-second long wide shot of you marking out cut lines on 2x4s, you can probably cut that one out. Get to the action. I hope you find these tips helpful. This is by no means an exhaustive list. There are tens of other guidelines and thoughts that are running through my head when I'm making videos, and maybe I'll talk about those more in a future video. I want to give a special thanks to Ryan O'Connor. He's a filmmaker, my friend, and my co-host on Into the Spotlight, a podcast about creativity and the creative process. Over the past 2 years, Ryan has really opened my eyes to the world of filmmaking and cinematography and made me think a lot more critically about my own videos. Thanks, Ryan. Let me know in the comments if there are elements of my videos that you want me to talk more about. Music choice, cinematography, editing. Oh, I could go on for a while about editing. Anything. I would love to know what you want to hear about making videos. As always, thanks for watching and have a great day. B-roll, 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 B-roll. This is how you get views on your videos. You include a very cute animal. Oh, look at that. Look at that kitty. There she is. There she is. There are those eyes.